3D printing rocket engines? It seems these days that you can 3D print just about anything. Just on this channel, we've talked about 3D printed next-gen perovskite solar panels, houses, and the development of advanced toroidal propellers for boats and drones. So you probably shouldn't be surprised to learn that 3D printing is also making waves in rocket science. NASA has developed a revolutionary new rocket engine that's 20 to 30% more efficient than anything else out there. Additive manufacturing techniques like 3D printing could make rockets quicker and cheaper, which could lead to better things for you and I down here on Earth. But how? I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. A portion of this video is brought to you by Incogni, but more on that later. Our phones help us stay in touch with our friends, check the weather, and help us find our way home. But it's easy to forget that these features all rely on commercial satellites. And these commercial satellites only exist because NASA has passed on their most successful tech to businesses. Even though we've been doing it for years, putting something like a satellite into space is costly, expensive, and time-consuming endeavor. Rocket assemblies in particular contain some of the most expensive and physically demanding components of the whole craft. And for reasons that we'll dig into a moment, additive manufacturing can speed up the process and make it cheaper. Perhaps most exciting of all, it's allowing us to realize advanced designs that weren't feasible with older manufacturing techniques. How? Well, I spoke to Paul Gradle, principal engineer at NASA and a general 3D printing slash additive manufacturing enthusiast, and here's what he had to say.
But now that we can go build these complex passages and we can use novel materials like GRCOP42 and GRX810, we have tested some rotating detonation rocket engines. Now with these engines, we get a 20 to 30% over traditional engines, which
That's
is
incredible.
You know, fantastic, because I remember back in shuttle days and some of the other development programs, we would chase after a 0.5% or 1% performance improvement, which was huge. And now you're talking in order of magnitude more than that. So additive manufacturing is definitely changing the way that we can, you know, think about some of these advanced propulsion concepts too.
Now these numbers are truly impressive, but to understand exactly why these rotating detonation rocket engines, or RDREs, are such a big deal, let's get into some further context. It takes incredible amounts of energy to get something into orbit, and every extra ounce requires extra propulsion. But fuel itself is very heavy. As a result, rockets have to be mostly fuel. The fuel alone counts for 90 to 95% of a rocket's weight. For comparison, just 4% of your car's weight is fuel. And even top-of-the-line fighter jets are only about 30% fuel by weight. That's why developing propulsion systems like RDREs is so important. They can save time and money by getting further with less fuel, with less weight, and less money. So how much better are RDREs? A standard gas turbine engine has a thermodynamic efficiency of about 36.9%, while an RDRE clocks in at almost double that with a thermodynamic efficiency of 59.3%. Now this is an astonishing improvement when you consider that for most of NASA's history, efficiency jumps of just 1% or less were cause for celebration. Furthermore, this design looks to be about 5% more fuel efficient than the standard. And that might not sound like much, but remember how 90% or more of a rocket's weight is fuel? Well, on a Falcon rocket, a 5% fuel savings comes out to about 103 metric tons of go juice. That's a lot less weight to carry around, much less to try to blast into space. So how can an RDRE accomplish this? Well, to understand how, we'll have to put our PPE on and break down how NASA gets rockets off the ground. Engines are driven by the burning of fuel to produce an expansion of gas. And even this engine in your car is powered by a tiny but powerful gas expansions. A rocket engine is very similar. During liftoff, an injector aerosolizes the fuel and a flame combusts it to generate thrust in a process called deflagration. But what if we could make this explosion better? What if we could ramp it up? Enter the RDRE development by NASA's Rapid Analysis and Manufacturing Propulsion Technology Division, or RAMPT for short. Now in this design, the fuel-to-air mixture starts to deflagrate like normal, but then quickly detonates, producing shockwaves that travel around the inside of the device at 2,000 meters per second. Now eventually, and I say eventually, but the whole process takes microseconds, these waves establish a rotating shockwave moving in one direction that circles the chamber every 0.1 millisecond. The rotating wave slams into the next burst of air and fuel mixture entering the combustor, causing it to detonate, and then that process repeats itself, generating more thrust more efficiently than a standard deflagration engine. And if you'd like to know more about how this works, Real Engineering has a great video about this that I'll link to in the description. But what does this have to do with 3D printing? Well, before I get into that, I'd like to thank today's sponsor, Incognito, who can help protect your online privacy. I've mentioned this before, but I signed up for a newsletter from a small online retailer, and after I did, I saw a major increase in the number of promotional emails I was receiving from companies I've never heard of. This happened again just a couple of weeks ago, and that's because they sold my information to a data broker. I'm sure you've experienced it too. Incognito can help you with this. We have the right to request that data brokers delete our information, but it takes a lot of time and effort. I signed up for Incognito, gave them the legal right to work on my behalf, and then just sat back and relaxed. You'll see updates on your account for which data brokers they've sent legal requests to and which ones have complied. It couldn't be easier. I've been letting Incognito stay on top of this for me for quite a while now, and I'm really, really happy with the results. They're staying on top of it for me, and I've noticed a big difference. If you want to take back some of the control around who has access to your personal information, give Incognito a try. The first 100 people to use the code UNDECIDED at the link below will get 60% off Incognito. Thanks to Incognito and to all of you for supporting the channel. So back to what RDREs have to do with 3D printing. Well, RDREs are looking more feasible every day thanks to a combo of freshly developed additive manufacturing techniques and new alloyed materials like GRCOP42.
We are able to make materials that didn't exist prior to additive. And in some cases, they're new families of materials. And some examples are GRCOP42. It's a copper chrome niobium material that we use for high conductivity, high strength for rocket combustion chambers.
Now, the high strength is obviously desirable when you're dealing with massive ongoing explosions and shockwaves inside of an RDRE, but the thermal conductivity is important too. Now, this ties directly into additive manufacturing, so hang with me for just a second. Last-gen rocket engine models can easily hit temperatures of 6,000 degrees Fahrenheit or about 3,300 degrees Celsius. RDREs are even more extreme. The high temperatures would cause the rocket engines to melt if they didn't have adequate cooling. The high thermal conductivity of GRCOP42 allows the alloy to conduct heat away from the rocket, giving it a mechanism to cool down more quickly. However, heat still needs to be transferred away from the GRCOP42 into some other medium to prevent it from melting. A popular technique called regenerative cooling performs heat transfer, allowing us to create super heat-tolerant rocket engines. Now, while this sounds great, there's a problem. Regenerative cooling works by pumping some of the super cold rocket fuel through channels on the engine to keep everything cool. But machining all those intricate channels takes a lot of time and money. But 3D printing comes in handy here too. By simply using CAD for the channels, the manufacturing process will print them fully integrated, saving time and money. The benefits of additive manufacturing extends to other parts of RAMP's RDRE as well. The shape of the engine is carefully printed to harness the power of the detonation and help keep the shockwave pulse rotating. The tiny cooling valves are part of the additive manufacturing process too, along with the thrust chamber. And while we're still in the testing phase, the outlook is very positive. The RDRE prototype produced more than 4,000 pounds of thrust for nearly a minute. Pressure inside the engine also reached 622 pounds per square inch, which NASA says is the highest pressure rating for this design on record. Now, that's a specific record for an additive manufactured engine like this. There's still a lot of room to go because internal pressure of existing rocket engines ranges from 700 to 3,500 PSI. Now, this is all very cool, space-agey stuff, so much so that it can be hard to picture how this is going to benefit us back here on Earth. I promise you, you'll see benefits sooner than you might think, and you might be surprised at the ways NASA's tech is ending up in your home. The first way these advances will impact us Earthlings is through price. The unique, physically massive, and complex engineering of rocketry means before you can build a rocket to experiment with, let alone send it into space, you first need to build the tools to build the rocket. This entails a lot of design iterations, prototyping, tons of testing, and expensive custom machining. It all adds up to create a very long wait between missions and high price tags. However, with additive manufacturing, you can start by building the tools or the parts that you need in CAD software and then print them. This can cut down on the time between tests, which reduce costs, and can also really accelerate the speed of innovation. 3D printing can reduce weight by reducing complexity, which knocks the cost down even further. Almost anything that currently requires a laborious, handmade process could benefit from additive manufacturing. And here's Paul on the time and money savings.
Traditionally, making combustion chambers, right, took 6 months, 12 months in some cases, assuming that I could get my forgings and, you know, machining goes well and my brazing and welding and everything goes well. on that. Well, with additive manufacturing, we're able to get an order of magnitude or better in many cases on lead times. So parts that were taking me months or years to make, I can make in days and months now. And okay. With that comes huge cost savings, right?
Because yeah.
A lot of the parts we're working with, aerospace, nothing is cheap. Everything from our large components to the fasteners and seals that we use are all specialty. So some of these components can be hundreds of thousands of dollars, if not millions of dollars. So even if I get a few percent cost savings on it, that's huge. With additive, there's many cases where we see 50% or greater cost savings.
By producing cheaper, more efficient rockets, the cost of satellite deployment is also reduced. This could mean less expensive, more plentiful satellites, and cheaper, easier access to everything that they provide, from data collection and transmission, asset tracking, imaging, and more. For example, satellite service Starlink is bringing the internet to places that have previously been unable to build out the necessary infrastructure to get online. They're not 3D printing, they're finding other ways to reduce costs, so you can see the benefits of those reduced costs. With the UN deeming internet access as a human right, more satellite internet providers are a net good. Your phone is another example of technology that uses the services provided by commercial satellites. Who knows what new waves of innovation might stem from easier access to those satellites? But as amazing as additive manufacturing is, it isn't a cure-all. Not everything can or should be fabricated with these techniques.
There are certain challenges that we can talk later, but I think it's easy to say additive manufacturing, I'm hearing all this stuff about it, it's a cool new kid on the block, I want to go use it for everything. Well, there's still a lot of great manufacturing technologies, machining, that I can do much quicker for simpler parts and high production rates.
There's also a steep learning curve. If you've ever 3D printed something at home, you know how hard it can be to translate your ideas into CAD. With all the scaffolding and warping, there's also a lot of trial and error in the printing process itself. In our discussion, Paul noted that they have to deal with those same exact issues when working on rocket pieces. And even though CAD and additive manufacturing opens a lot of doors, there's still some angles and shapes that just aren't achievable with those tools yet. And it can take a lot of time to train someone in CAD and get them caught up with all the best practices, lest they make a very costly mistake. Now, additive manufacturing is the flashy new toy. And because of that, it's going to be misapplied to all sorts of things before it finds a niche. But all that said, it really does look like 3D printing is set to revolutionize rocketry and everything that relies on it. Best of all, NASA wants to spread the knowledge around.
Another side of NASA too is, you know, not just being a player in the game, but we're also helping to be the, you know, the commissioner of the team of sorts, right? We are setting some of the rules in industry in terms of standards and certification. And if we're going to do that and establish those rules, we need to understand the details of it. So NASA has taken on a lot of roles as well in terms of certification. We've developed some very extensive documents for how do you certify additively manufactured parts for human spaceflight.
And we mentioned Starlink, but NASA's working with the California-based company Relativity Space to push rocketry even further with those new materials and 3D printing techniques. This March, the company launched a largely 3D printed rocket with 3D printed engines, thrusters, and parts made from GRCOP42. And that partnership could actually deserve its own video. Now, NASA also passed the research baton off to a slew of partner universities like Cornell, Stanford, Texas A&M, and more. The point is, NASA is an excellent springboard for innovation, alley-ooping research to lots of partners who can turn it into a slam dunk. And while you may never ride on a rocket with 3D printed parts, these breakthroughs should still excite you. Because the technology NASA and their partners cook up for space exploration has a funny way of improving our lives back here on Earth. The joystick on your PlayStation controller, the filter in your water purifier, the insole of your running shoes, or the camera in your cell phone, and much, much more, all come from NASA R&D. Again, even if they never find earthly applications for this specific technology, it will still benefit us all. GPS, weather satellites, and the internet are all important things that we use every day. The first step is to develop the hardware that makes new ideas like these possible. So what do you think of additive manufacturing? Any other exciting applications? Jump in the comments and let me know. And be sure to check out my follow-up podcast, Still to Be Determined, where we'll be discussing some of your feedback. And thanks to all my patrons who get ad-free versions of every video. I'll see you in the next one.